Hey folks, welcome to Giant Bombs GDC 2013 After Hours Show. I'm Ryan Davis. We have a panel of game industry professionals. Everyone, there's a kind of
not so awesome.
Yeah, people kind of shaking their heads. No, not a lot of agreement on that statement. Let's run down the line here. Everyone, introduce yourselves.
Sure, I am Garth Angelus. I was a producer on XCOM: Enemy Unknown.
Oh, Giant Bomb's Game of the Year for 2012.
Why? Yes, that is a fact. I forgot about that.
Was it?
Yeah. That's what happened.
I blocked out all those arguments.
It was not Saints Row the Third, unfortunately.
Okay, all right.
Yeah,
all right.
No, yeah.
I'm good. I'm clear.
We'll get back to that.
I'm Casey O'Toole, the lead programmer on XCOM.
Excellent. Hey, that was Giant Bomb's Game of the Year for 2012.
Damn right it was.
That's the answer I'm looking for.
See what you did there. Mark McDonald, I work at 8-4.
Indeed.
Sister podcast to the Giant Bombcast, at least we like to think so.
Yeah, no.
8-4 Play.
We think so as well.
Okay, good.
Absolutely.
Right, I didn't want to speak for you, so.
And also, you know, long time game.
X1 Up and EGM and all that.
No, I recognize you. I used to read you all the time. Yeah.
Oh.
Right, kind of weird, I guess, but I did.
There you go.
Yeah.
We'll get into, well, you know what? This is the GDC After Hours thing, so it's just going to get weird.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about what's going on at GDC, which is apparently just rampant alcoholism. So
that's it's what the conference is.
Mm-hmm. It turns out you get a bunch of game industry professionals together, and all they know how to do is just drink.
Right, especially ones that have just shipped a game.
Yes.
Well, it's kind of been a while, but I like to use that excuse.
In the grand scheme of things,
it's
still feels...
like 5 months ago, I shipped a game, so...
like, the wounds are still just starting to heal.
I'll still be using that excuse 2 years from
now. Yeah, I know. You're not the irrational guys. Like, those guys can drink right now. They've earned that.
They're working on DLC. They can drink later.
And then Jeff Gerstmann's here.
Hello. Hi. Good to be here.
And that rounds out the panel, so...
like I'm watching you do it. I practically know it's coming.
Yep.
And I'm still like,
Yep.
Fucking worst.
It's John Drake from Harmonix, ladies and gentlemen. Such a professional.
He's wearing professional shoes.
I want to make sure that I do this right. I'd like to welcome the San Francisco Gay Men's Drum and Bugle Corps, everybody. No, they couldn't come. Brett Shoemaker, ladies and gentlemen. Effectively the Gay Men's Drum and Bugle Corps of GiantBomb.com. I've worked on Dance Central 3, not Giant Bomb's Game of the Year, not even really in the top 10.
No.
Because fuck you guys. It's a good game. Whatever.
It is a good game.
I've heard it's a good game. I've heard it's okay, depending on who's playing it.
I've heard it's
occasionally... I like watching you play it.
Yeah, I guess.
I like watching you dance.
When you play it, it works.
Yeah, that's true. I make that game work. I don't have anything to talk about.
Let's start with you.
All right, great.
John Drake, what are you doing at GDC?
Fuck, nothing. Just hanging out with people at night.
Well, it's good that you made the cross-country sprint right after PAX East.
I had a lot of meetings. I got a lot of work done on that flight. It's been good. And then I went to some panels today. It's the first time I've gone to the panels in a long time. The first time we're ever like not doing demos or pitches during like behind closed doors. Like the secret GDC.
So you've just got no games.
Like last year, yeah, you were just like locked up with a ton of Kettle Corn.
Doing
and
secret Rock Band Blitz demos.
Yeah, so that's right. Secret.
Johnny tweeted it out. So I played some Disney Infinity. I'm happy to tell you all about the things that were not in your quick look yesterday that are all secrets.
Ooh, great. Let's hear about it.
Break it down. We got all the secrets already.
Yeah, it's true. He was actually being pretty forthcoming about things, and he's like, this is probably going to come from the game, but I'll show it to you now. And I was like, you shouldn't do that. That's not how PR works. Don't tell people things that are going to make you get fired. No, I don't know. So I've just been around and going to some talks. I went to the micro talks today, like the sort of speedy talks that Richard Lemarchand hosts.
Oh, okay.
And so they do, you have 6 minutes, and they get speakers, and you have 6 minutes to talk, and your slides have to auto-advance like every 10 seconds. So there's these rules, and so it's like you just have to kind of keep going and going and going, and there's some really good ones.
It was really fun. Speed dating equivalent of the GDC panel.
Is it next year just going to be like Vine panels?
Yep, 6 seconds of Vines over and over again. It was really
Vines
fun.
Are the future.
Gamification! Just that's it.
China's coming! That was the panel I went to the end of the day.
Sexism!
Tencent's like, China's getting phones soon, and it's going to be terrible. Mobile games forever.
I'm out!
MPD. That was the entire panel. It was a disaster. And I'm
here. But there is also, aside from like the panels and stuff, there is a lot of other business being done at GDC.
Yeah, people wheeling and dealing.
Yeah, pitching, happening. And
Give me some monies. That's pretty much all of GDCs.
No.
So we've been
I mean, your last game didn't even make Giant Bomb's Game of the Year
list.
Yeah,
I know, right? Why would anyone invest in us? clearly, everyone's watching the Giant Bomb Game of the Year top 10.
Well, you know, we did have, you know, all of the Disney Infinity direct feed footage out of GDC, so.
It's true. You guys got the exclusive.
If you want good Disney coverage, obviously, you partner with Giant Bomb.
Infinity is the Skylanders thing,
yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So
yes.
Are you guys?
Yes, it is.
Totally okay.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So, and nothing 100%. More.
But you guys are really into the Skylanders thing. Are you?
Jeff and Ryan's way into it.
Are you on board with the? Okay.
Jeff is way into the Skylanders stuff.
To clarify,
I think I'm more into the Disney side of it.
Okay, so you guys are going to be on board with this Infinity thing, buying all the figures.
It's pretty cool, actually.
It's a bit. It looks like a better game. The thing with Skylanders, especially the second one. It's a slow moving game that they're kind of making a kid's game.
Yeah.
So it's kind of brain dead simple. And the first time out, the novelty of all the figures and stuff carried me through that.
Right.
I was like, this game's actually pretty good.
Right.
For what it is. The second time out though, it's like, okay, this is kind of the same thing, and all of this stuff is kind of showing through. The third Skylanders, they're letting you rip the figures in half.
Yeah.
And reattach them and put them on the base and making and also different developer, faster game. Like looks. Yeah. Potentially okay.
Everything old is new.
Infinity,
way different.
Similar concept, but yeah, like totally different game. You know, so their whole thing is they're trying to sell play sets based on the movies. So you'll buy like the Cars set, or it comes with the Cars set or whatever. And then you play the Cars set with the Cars vehicles, or the Cars characters, I guess. And there's gameplay built around that.
So, like a little cloistered world where you were just playing Cars and a Cars playset that's separate.
But then you're like
If you put on the Pirates of the Caribbean playset, it's not going to be a driving game still.
Right.
It'll be something else.
But I mean, can you
a
driving game with boats?
Yeah. Is this ostensibly like not just for kids, or can you tell? I mean,
so it's definitely not though, because I think that there's a whole playset
so
in the middle.
There's so many Disney weirdos. Yeah. So there's this toy box mode in the middle that lets you start to mix all that stuff together.
Okay.
So you can be like, all right, I'm the dude from The Incredibles, and we've got Epcot Center here and all this other weird Disney
but
shit.
But like the gameplay and stuff like that, it's not like the simplicity level.
It looks like a good kid's game.
It looks like, the playsets where you're actually inside that world looks like a kid's game, right? Like the Cars playset.
Yeah.
When you're playing the Cars gameplay, it'll be like a kid's game where you're playing Cars gameplay. But that toy box thing, because there's like a world building element and a gameplay design element, like you can actually build like side scrolling Contra, basically. Like,
Disney characters. It's almost like a little
bit of Planet thing. It's a little bit Minecraft,
cross bound soccer goals, and then wire that up to a scoreboard.
Right. Yeah. It's a cool idea. I'm just wondering.
I wonder who will grab onto it.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And I'm wondering with you guys too, and with people who kind of the collection aspect really appeals to, and like the figurine, like where the line is drawn now. Nintendo, you know, Pokemon is happening next. Like, are you guys on board for that, or is that like below the line?
Is there a Pokemon Skylanders game coming?
Yeah,
that would be
basically near field communication.
But they're going to sell them out of capsule machines in Japan,
to start at least. Yeah. And you can only buy it at the Pokemon Center. You can only buy it at like three places on the Earth to begin with. I don't know why.
Brilliant marketing.
It's where Pokemon are born.
Yeah.
I think it's just to get the hype levels going, but I'm curious if that shit is actually going to cross
my
over.
Whole thing is, the rub with me is, I think I look at Infinity and go, that looks really cool. That's something I want to mess with. But I just don't care about any Disney properties.
Sure.
With the exception of Tron, which there's a little bit of Tron stuff in there, but not enough to, like I never saw The Incredibles. I look at those guys and go, like, it's super, whatever.
If you like Pixar, so it's not Disney as much as it is, like, Pixar property.
Yeah,
I mean, there's
yeah.
Disney properties that are also going to be in there, but so far, most of the things they've announced are, like, monsters, Cars, Incredibles.
I think that might be it, right?
There's other stuff that's in there, but I don't know what's announced
like full
or not.
But not,
like,
play sets,
I won't bust
but
John.
But it sounds
out.
Like they
Johnny
have,
blew up your
he
spot.
Did.
Let's
ruined
do
my
it.
Life.
It sounds like they have a lot of ambition for, like, what that's ultimately going to include and, like, who that will appeal to. Like, they left a couple of the little figures, little toys that are, you know, going to be your markers or whatever. They're well made. Like, those seem like good little
things.
They've
got a heft to them. Like, if you hit someone, like, if you packed it like a
just wing it at someone.
Like a little pewter. Just spun around and hit somebody with it.
You wouldn't even need to bolo it. I think you could just, you know, overhand throw from here, and
it's
a
versatile weapon, I think is what we're saying.
Yeah.
Disney's designing a really dangerous game.
I'm just kind of curious. Like,
big enough that you can't swallow it.
Well,
John.
I don't think you can say that on camera.
Exactly.
There's legal implications to that.
When Lil' Kim wrote that line about making a Sprite can disappear in her mouth, he's talking about.
I was just kind of curious if the level was, because anytime there's a Disney thing, it's like, so Kingdom Hearts kind of crossed over a little bit where it actually got some older gamers and people into it. If it was going to be one of those, or literally it was just a kid's game that nobody could just say it's a kid's game. but really ends up
it's
being
like so
simple. It's
a kid's game with adult, with some depth to it. I think that like adults could do some stuff
and
with it.
And they've got the potential down the road. I mean, you know, now that they're Marvel and they're Lucas, like, you know, if
Star
this
Wars
thing,
cross Iron Man.
If John Vignacchi doesn't ruin this entire project along the way and make it tank.
Which, like, what's the likelihood of that not happening?
The thing's on fire. What?
It's already got delayed once.
At some point, they will, you know, get to that thing, and that's probably where it starts to get a little older.
Right. But I'll say this to you. We're a bunch of grown men on a video game, core video game podcast, talking about Disney. And I don't know when the last time that happened was, so that's pretty interesting.
A few years ago with King.
Epic Disney.
I guess Epic Mickey, too. Yeah.
Like, yeah, pretty recently.
DuckTales.
So Kingdom Hearts. Constantly we're talking
DuckTales. But they're not putting out DuckTales. Capcom's putting out DuckTales.
I know, but it's Disney.
Don't step to me. But I'm talking about Disney like as an entity, not Disney. Like that's a like a side thing. They have a licensing chunk. They're not like making that game. They're making this game, Ryan.
Just let that.
All their resources are making this game. And a new cat game called Mittens that I just watched a trailer for outside. Which
sounded awesome.
It was one of the worst trailers I've ever seen.
Well, let's get off Disney stuff, John.
Please. All I ever want to do is get off that.
I want to talk more about your GDC experience. You talk about the micropanels. Anything else that you've experienced at the show?
I went, and so Manveer from BioWare gave a talk at that, and it was really cool. He talked about Pop! OEO and how, about like sort of being vulnerable as a game designer and putting your story out there and how he found it really inspiring. He doesn't want to make games that don't have that in them anymore, and it was a really nice talk. He talked about his family stuff, and it's, I mean, his story to tell, so I don't want to like repeat what he said, but
at the end, he just said, like, I'm Commander Shepard.
Right. It started off with
I am the Citadel.
He was talking about Papa and Yo, but it started off with like, you're a boy and you're scared in the universe. And I was like, is this a weird like Mass Effect 3 weird retelling thing? I don't want the Dream Kid to come back. Star Kid is
he's on fire.
Yeah,
oh God.
David Bowie's predecessor. But no, so he gave a really nice talk, and Lee Alexander talked about growing up and basically like the games industry getting their shit together and not being pandering. I don't know what she was talking about in particular, but probably everything that we do, because she's not wrong. And then other stuff, like, I don't know, I've been walking around, I've just been running into people on the streets. I want to go to that photo booth that you went to and get my GDC yearbook photo taken.
Nick Chester's photo, pretty good.
Pretty good. Yours is pretty good. Gary Whitta's photo.
Gary Whitta's the winner so far.
Did you see Pachter?
No.
Pachter's
pretty good. Understand the concept? Or was he just was a photo of Michael Pachter being Michael Pachter?
So Pachter dragged me over there. You saw us when we were doing the Game Trailers bonus round thing. And Pachter tried to grab me, like all four of us, me, Keeley, Annie Mac.
If folks want to see this at home, go to Facebook.
Go to Facebook, the I Am 8-Bit page. They've got all these pictures up there. They're all fantastic.
Number 8.
And Pachter's like, whatever, we're going to go be like a metal band or something. Come on. And Andy's like, I got a life to lead.
And
Keeley was just like double phoning it and walked away.
Face first to a pillar in the middle of the convention
center. And I'm still standing there and I'm like, yeah, fuck it, I'll go with you. Come on.
Turned out great.
So we get there. Pachter, he sees a little boom box and he goes, can I be black? And I'm like, oh no! What the fuck is going on?
Now I want to go see.
They did not go down that road.
The makeup artist is like, no, blackface isn't in this year really so much.
At some point, someone did have to say no.
Jesus Christ.
And I was like, Pachter, you're
can I be a Chinaman? Can I be a... can I,
Here's the game industry's most respected analyst.
Yep.
Asking most about
quoted,
blackface.
Most quoted, for sure.
Yeah, at least that.
Most quoted.
That's a good clarification.
That was super fun. And they're running a cool thing. That's, you know, if you're going to be there tomorrow, where is it? Moscone North.
Show's been pretty good, though, overall. I mean, like, that's a cool, fun thing. Overall, the show seems all right. The GDC app is, like, nightmare device on your phone.
But someone was saying it was hard to even see the things by time.
Completely useless.
I got to the point where it said, give me a login and password, and I was like, I don't have what?
So I went and created one, and I was just trying to use the full browser website, and that was still a complete mystery. So
information architecture, not their strong suit, but the panels themselves are pretty cool. There's a lot of good stuff. I saw a lot of people go into the Journey talk today and giving Genova a big standing ovation.
They won every award last night, right?
Yeah, everything. Cleaning up, which means it's great. It means next year they can no longer win awards, and we can maybe move on.
Right.
I mean, I think Journey's unbelievable, it would be nice to hear.
I think this is the moment where you can kind of close the book on Journey and go like this. we all agree, was Journey an amazing, was amazing game.
Right.
Didn't it come out like 15 months ago? Like, hasn't it been out for a long time?
It feels like it's been out since the 70s. Right. I don't know.
I know, but I mean, played it on the Atari 2600.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Like,
you're the block, Coleco, and then you go along, and then there's like, you're the yellow block, and then there's like this red block? Like, who is that?
Right.
The red block's all freaking out, and it's getting the sword, like, and then it just runs off, and then there's another red block in the next screen, and it's just fucking weird.
Do you know what his talk was about? Because he gave an awesome talk at DICE about... that was where it came out about that they actually went bankrupt making Journey and everything, but like actually really inspiring, like great.
I don't know, but I know that people were all tweeting like, I'm like at this Journey panel and I am crying, this is so moving and powerful, and I'm like, all right, like you're in like a really sterile fluorescent lit conference center with like bad lighting, like if you can cry in that environment.
But you're also like just shockingly hungover.
Yes.
So your emotional vulnerability level is pretty high.
I'm so raw. In like both in the chafing and the emotional.
Pretty raw.
I'm so chafing.
You're Eddie Murphy.
I've been getting all the fuel points. I've been walking around all day. It's been great.
Just full leather outfit.
I've been got tackled by Dave Lang.
Rings over the leather gloves.
Yeah, you know,
always
you gotta,
a good look.
I mean, if I'm spending money on the rings and I want to hide them, you got to show off. That's investment.
I got these isotoners. My hands got to be warm.
Now that you've gamified your movement, does it make you move more?
It makes me sad when I move less, but it doesn't make me move more. Okay. I'm pretty still sedentary. But yeah, and then Dave Lang dragged me across Yerba Buena Gardens screaming at like 1:30 in the morning about how he wanted to get drinks at the Marriott, and then he pretended to barf, and then he yelled at me when we got to the Marriott for bringing him to the Marriott, even though he was he's the worst. I'm sorry I did a TNT with him today. I'm happy for his game, I guess, if you can call it a game. I hope that they temp in the real art sometime soon, but other than that, it's, you know, Dave Lang's a human monster.
We gave him some shit about it.
Good.
GDC, where everyone just talks mad shit about whoever's not in the room.
I like this. I like this new, like, developers talking about each other's games.
Yeah,
this
is a new That's it. That's what I'm doing.
Mark McDonald actually has gay relationships that he needs to maintain, so he can't talk that level of shit. But,
that's right. I cannot. Every game is amazing, and
they're all wonderful.
Don't worry. Very interesting.
Buy more copies of them.
We're not translating this into Japanese, so you can say what you
want.
As long as you don't localize the panel later, we should be fine.
Yes. No. We're doing a lot of that for the panels, some of the Japanese speakers.
Oh, are you really?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Excellent.
Yeah, we're working with GDC, so everything about GDC, any of the bad stuff, I don't agree with.
No, great app.
The app is amazing.
Works great with kanji characters.
Yep.
Sure looks
the
great.
The information infrastructure is outstanding. we're only doing a couple English speeches in the Japanese, but all the Japanese speakers we set up and are doing over, so there have been a couple good talks.
Have you done that before?
Yeah, last year was the first year that we did it.
I mean, you guys have become just kind of this go-to house for this stuff, like
Well, I didn't want to, you know.
I'm going to set you up.
That's okay.
All right. Name me another.
You guys seem like kind of a big deal in the localization game.
There's the Treehouse, and there's you guys, as far as I'm.
And then there's the Treehouse.
Take it,
how we like to think about it. No.
That's cool.
Come down from Seattle.
So we had a bunch of games all come out at the same time that we worked on like the last 2 years, which is weird, but sometimes that happens. You finish a game and then it's like...
It did seem like there was a good 3 month period where it was just like all this stuff coming
out. So Fire Emblem, Monster Hunter, which by the way, I almost forgot. So Japanese tradition is to bring gifts. And Jeff, I know you asked for that specifically from Japan.
Oh, awesome.
That was making us look bad.
I thought, you know, everyone was going to bring gifts. And,
you know, I know.
We just met, but
I know to hold it with both hands.
Very kind of you. This says Monster Hunter on it. Is it poison? Is it dung?
It might be, because they sell pretty much everything Monster Hunter brand.
Awesome.
Can I see this for
a second? Yeah, yeah.
These are like little kind of cakes. There's hot cake flavor, strawberry flavor, or white and cookie flavor. So
white and cookie sounds amazing.
It could be any of those. It could be any of those flavors. It's kind of open it and find out.
Some indistinct packaging.
I honestly don't know what that is, Jeff. I think it's some kind of gummy candy.
It's from the Monster Hunter.
There are definitely cats hatching out of eggs.
There are cats hatching,
which is not how cats work. Japan.
Have you seen Japanese cats lately?
No. Stay corrected.
So Monster Hunter is our most recent game. I actually played online some with Patrick. That was pretty fun.
I was going to say, you've been enabling Klepek.
I've been trying to.
Get him
down that
path. I
basically went to Capcom PR and was like, listen, give me a copy of your game, the English version, before it comes out, because I am your best PR weapon, because I understand the game and can explain it in a way that the game does not honestly explain itself. So like the
and they said like psh, yeah whatever here you go
yeah well they did
there
yeah,
you go
like good man go
it's a gummy
go
paw.
With God
a gummy paw just all one right. gummy paw
All Japanese candy is like this. This is not a.
There's more. It's not one candy pop. One gummy candy.
But yeah, like I've been known drums. To play some to hunt some monsters. So it was good to play with Patrick. I think the interesting thing about Monster Hunter, people have the same review, and one person will score it a 5. I read your old review, which this still holds true, and I honestly think it does. And you gave it like a 5.75, and I'm like. I can't disagree with a whole lot said in this review.
I think it's just
and I'll find the same person who writes almost the same review and will give it a 9. It's like
it just depends on if it speaks to you or not. Like it's
basically totally how much shit you're willing to put up with until you get your reward. Like how much you're willing to delay gratification.
And the older I get, basically. The less I have.
I have a cream for that. Let me tell you about it.
Just numbs you up real good.
Yeah, it's great.
But yeah,
it's called heroin. You should try it.
No
awesome.
Complaints.
So basically that, Fire Emblem, and then Metal Gear, which I enjoyed you guys talking about Metal Gear a lot as well. Revengeance, Metal Gear Rising.
Oh, yes.
We did that.
I was going to say, I think you're missing like two or three words.
For that. Yeah.
The original NES Metal Gear, and that was you. I Feel Asleep.
That was us too. Yep.
Good work.
Yep. That was maybe not our best moment.
Can we not gloss over Fire Emblem, which is incredible?
Yeah. Thank you.
I've been playing the hell out of that game.
Oh, awesome. I'm so, like, it's awesome to have people, I think, even for Nintendo to see, like, oh shit, like, people want to buy this game, like, it's sold out, and, you know, they're selling a lot on download, but I don't even think they expected the amount of love.
Like, Fire Emblem's kind of been a thing for Nintendo for a long time, you know, in Japan, much more so, but, you know, there's definitely been kind of a core audience for it here, but I've seen this game blow up in a way in the States, unlike any of the other Fire Emblem games. So I think a lot of people are having their first Fire Emblem experiences on the 3DS, and it's hit them hard.
Yeah, and that was supposed to be their thing. We actually did an interview with the guys, and it hasn't come out because I think Nintendo is like editing the shit out of it. But we did an interview with the team, and basically they're like, let's throw all together. A bunch of games came out in Japan, Fire Emblem games that never came out here. And so they're like, let's take all the greatest elements from all these games that have ever come out, and hopefully anyone who's played any of those one games and not played the others will play it. And then hopefully people who never played it, you know, and a big thing being the casual versus classic mode. I don't know, what are you guys playing? Yeah. Classic or casual mode?
The classic, because it touches a lot of the same nerves for me that XCOM does. You know, I think if you like XCOM, you'll love Fire Emblem.
A lot of people.
Back on box quote right there.
So what are you guys going to rip off from Fire Emblem for the next XCOM game?
Like, baby, what Stanley's squad mates right next to
babies
each
by far.
Generations of soldiers.
You can one up them with same sex marriage. If you guys
throw same sex soldier marriage,
that's the next step. Fire Emblem does not have same-sex marriage.
We're breaking down these barriers, goddammit!
Do it.
I think we're going to take their audio system, so every time you hit the A button, they say, like, the same verse over and over and over again. Regardless of this long piece of text, it's just like, yes, okay.
That's awesome. That's really awesome to hear that you guys are playing it and digging it. But because a lot of people did bring up XCOM and Fire Emblem and even and Skulls of the Shogun as kind of a just little strategy renaissance.
Yeah, it's like turn-based strategy just
totally
blew back up there's late a strong, 2012.
Yeah, there's a strong cross-pollination there. And it really did seem like Fire Emblem took the media world, the video game media world by storm when that came out. I mean, it seemed like all the editors were loving it. And I think that trickled to, you know, who they represent, which are those passionate fans. And I was so happy to see you guys sell what you sold.
Yeah.
We need more types of games like this.
I mean, I don't want to like undercut Fire Emblem at all, but I also feel, you know, part of it is just people were just fucking hungry for something like 3DS.
Yep.
I'd want something to put in the system. Like, I hear Fire Emblem's great.
No
people
doubt.
tell me that I should play this. They start it, and then it's like, oh yeah, I'm hooked. Let's go. Yeah.
It's a shame though, because I think there's a lot of people that would love that game that won't ever have the opportunity to play it because. It still doesn't seem like that many people have 3DSs.
I didn't have one before.
Right.
It is a game that I think...
That's cool to hear.
And
a lot
I tell people,
yeah.
I was like, you may want to go out and buy a 3DS just to play this game. I think it's that good.
I think Drew bought his for Monster Hunter.
Yep.
Yep, I gave him my copy of Monster Hunter, and then he bought a 3DS, so I feel at least partially responsible for that.
Yeah, my thing about Monster Hunter 2 is, like, if you're new to the series, do not buy the 3DS version.
Yeah.
Unless you have four other people around you that are going to play regularly, you got to play online with other people, so start off with the Wii U version, and then if it hooks you, then play the 3DS version.
That's what you guys were trying to play on the plane, right?
They were, yes.
On the way out, like Patrick and Vinny, and that sounded like
I think
kind
they were shooting Wi-Fi signals across that plane.
Danger zone, guys. You can bring a plane down with your Monster Hunters.
I was playing, you know, Luigi's Mansion over by myself. I was being responsible.
So how is that, by the way? Have you guys already talked about that to death?
I had like this much battery on my 3DS and it died. And
okay.
I have not gotten that much.
It sounds like it is incredibly charming. And,
yeah.
And good things about it.
A lot of fun.
Surprised fan. Like I didn't like. It was one of those things where they started talking about this game, and I started realizing, like, wait, I actually am kind of a huge fan of the original Luigi's Mansion. I didn't really realize that fact that I had this fondness for it. Because I remember playing it at the time, thinking like, this looks great. Like it had just such a great visual style. Which you know, we played it on our Friday show not that long ago, and was sort of like, wow, this actually still holds up. Like a lot of the aesthetic stuff still. Totally awesome.
Cool.
But I remember at the time also feeling like, this gameplay kind of runs down after a while, and there are elements that get a little repetitive. But when they announced it, I was like, oh my god, I'm totally ready for a new Luigi's Mansion game. And so, what I've played of it, it seems like they've changed just enough of just kind of the core gameplay loop, just a little bit.
Right.
That it feels a little
different.
It needed something,
right? Like the first game, as a launch game, I think a lot of people were like, I wanted my Mario game.
I think that's a big part of it, is like, everyone felt like, with the launch of the GameCube, of like, this is our Mario substitute, is this Luigi game, and that colored that reception.
Haters gonna hate. It's the year of Luigi. He's back. Fuck up your mansion.
I thought every year was the year of Luigi.
Yeah, I don't
know what's on. And then they're like, 2013 is the year of Luigi. I'm like, all right, I guess we'll just skip it over the year of Mario.
When's the fucking year of Wario? Let's do this.
Bring back Wario.
I don't know, the Chinese calendar doesn't make any sense to me. So I don't.
Racist.
I don't get it at all. It is charming as hell. There is some really funny writing in it right off the bat. So there's, Treehouse coming at you guys.
One thing I noticed, a little subtle thing about that, probably nobody will notice, but that was developed externally, right? Like Next Level Games.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah, did that. But at startup, it actually doesn't show their logo.
Huh.
So you might be like, oh man, what the hell? Like, this is like a slight at those guys. But actually, that's like the highest honor that as a Nintendo game you can get, is because Nintendo is like, we're willing to have people just think that this came out of NCO.
Oh, wow.
So, like, in Japan, like, most people just think that's an NCO game. So that's them saying, like, yep, we're...
It's both a huge compliment to how well they did the game that Nintendo would put their own name on, and also probably not the most greatest thing for their brand in terms of spreading it around, that no one will ever see their logo ever.
Well,
because I had heard that that game had been done forever.
Yeah.
And that they finally got it out, and I was a huge fan of Punch-Out, so... I hope that this does well for them and they get to keep, working with Nintendo.
Truth.
So, Mark, anything else you're
you're
doing here in town you can talk about?
We're doing Fire Emblem DLC is still coming out.
I mean, just at GDC, like, what you're up to? Is it meeting time all the time?
Yeah, there's a lot of meeting time. Actually, some potentially interesting stuff. So we brought Sword and Sorcery out in Japan.
Right. So you're going the other way as well.
So we're doing some of that stuff, and it's, the whole indie thing that's going on, it's pretty awesome to see an indie game and have a legit reason to come up to these guys and talk, like the Samurai Gun guys. Because I see that game and I'm like, I want to bring this out in Japan. Like, this game looks fucking awesome. And there's like a legit reason to go up and talk to people and be like,
So you're finding there's a market for that stuff?
Yeah. I
mean, in Japan?
Well, as much as, with Sorcery, there definitely was.
Yeah.
We're not like, crazy AAA. We're running like small guerrilla style stuff, but we run small and lean, and we make our money back in like a week or two. And with Sorcery and with a lot of these games, like, we actually just want to have people play them in Japan. And then we're also trying to do the other thing, where we're trying to get Japanese indies to bring their stuff out over here, because there's actually like a lot of them going on there, but for various reasons, it doesn't make sense for them to come out to the West. Mm-hmm. A lot of them.
La Mulana and stuff like the
not
enough.
Cave Story and La Mulana. Yeah. So you get like little peeks at it, but it's like, what's up? Why are we not? We're seeing like just a tidal wave from the West and not a whole lot from Japan. And a lot of it is just like ignorance. Like, they don't know what Steam is. They don't know. Steam is not a big market in Japan. There's a million pretty boring reasons why it is.
So you become like a semi-publisher of these games too, trying to kind of help them like really navigate not only just the actual translation, but the business model and all that stuff as well.
Exactly.
That's
exactly. Cool. So we our core business is localization. Right. So that's basically what we do. But what we want to do
now. Where the money's at.
What we want to do now, if only it were. But what we do now. Is like taking these games, and we get to like cherry pick too. It's pretty cool, because it's not like, shit, we got to bring 12 games out this year. Just grab whatever.
Madden coming out in Japan.
Not yet. That's gonna
be not yet. Yeah, exactly. Once we get the full 20,000 people machine up and running, then we'll start turning out the shit. But for now, for now, we're able to just to pick, like, this game looks awesome. I want people in Japan to play this game and vice versa. Sure. And also, there was this Bit Summit event that I don't know if you guys heard about, but we worked with James Milkey and some other people to kind of try to educate Japanese indies. And Valve came out, and a whole bunch of people came and spoke, Swery and a bunch of creators. Basically, the Tokyo Jungle guy said, like, you know, let your freak flag fly.
And I feel like that's been such a huge issue over, like, let's say, God, at this point, maybe the last 6 or 7 years, and part of why just my personal interest level in a lot of Japanese stuff has kind of waned. Because, like, you know, you go back to PS1, PS2 era, when it was like, you'd import some Japanese game, and it would just be so fucking insane, unlike anything else you had seen.
Yeah.
You couldn't understand any of the text, but what was happening on, like, matter. This banana's crying, I don't know why.
Where are the, like, the Katamaris, the baby universes, the bib ribbons, like, the kind
like
of crazy
Tokyo Jungle
shit?
Was the first.
LSD, where's the new LSD?
LSD, exactly.
Tokyo Jungle was the first, like,
where's the new Yoshinori game coming from?
Exactly, right? Like, so Tokyo Jungle is a good example of a game where we talked about that game a lot. I was like, this is the kind of game Sony was doing in PS1 and a little bit in PS2 era, and I actually think they really dropped the ball on PS3. As intelligent and smart and wonderful as Sony is as a client of ours, I think that's one little place where maybe they could have done a little bit better. But
I can understand
the
why.
Indies are doing that.
Yeah.
It's just not coming through. And so basically, yeah, these speeches, that was the crux of it, and I really hope that message gets out there.
But in the world of digital games, like, there's no reason why they should not be worldwide releases except for localization, and that can be it.
True.
But, like, there's no reason it should be on PSN anywhere, right?
Yeah. Is there a native platform in Japan for, like, equivalent of IGF, for instance, for these devs to show off what they're doing, the crazy shit they're doing?
There's, like, little showcases at TGS and stuff. There's, like, the Sense of Wonder night that they do that nobody knows about or covers or anything. Yeah,
somebody, there's a lot fabulous. Of glitter. It's pretty weird.
I was going to say, it sounds like a real dazzle crotch kind of moment.
But a lot of these guys are still doing the equivalent of selling their game in a Ziploc bag like it used to be at, like, in Akihabara. That's the only place you can buy it. It's a PC game. You cannot download it off the internet. There's no way there's no way to download this and to buy this. And part of it is because Steam isn't that big in Japan, but part of it is just because they made this game to make it and not to sell it.
Right.
But it's
like the whole the Toho series, like all those shooters and stuff.
Oh right. Yeah. So that the one of the other problems is that people will use these very well-known characters and well-known like game engines. And that gives them immediate, like, a little bit of popularity. Like, 1,000 people will definitely want to play their game. But written into the bylaws of using these characters, you cannot sell your game, like, to a foreign market.
It's
or
like
whatever.
Creative Commons licensing. It's like, as long as it's non-commercial and there's attribution, you can do whatever you want.
And there's a lot of these, like, weird things, which you see a game, and you're like, this game is amazing. Oh, but it uses this girl character that everybody knows and loves, and so therefore, you know, it's like beautiful, gorgeous Symphony of the Night, like, I mean, if you saw it out of the corner of your eye, you'd be like, holy shit, like, Iga made another, you know, Metroidvania game, but it's not. It's these indie guys. The Cybernator game, fucking amazing game. It's like, everyone should be playing this. You can sell this for $10 on Steam right now.
But is it legitimately using Cybernator assets?
It's not.
Okay.
That's the thing. It's not using any of that, but it will have, like,
derivative characters.
This one character that's like, you know, a well-known.
So is copyright law in Japan just complete madness? Is it just a total free-for-all?
I don't even know that much about it, but from what I know, like, the patent laws and copyright laws there are really different. But this is more like a community rule. It's like a really small, really hardcore clique of people who use these characters for their mostly comics and for games. And so it's just like you start to talk to them about it. And it's like, no. It's just not done. It's just, you know, these are these characters or whatever. Hmm. So part of it is, okay, next time make your game and how about don't use those characters?
And instead of
selling immediately and getting interest to those thousands of people, let's put it on Steam and Twitter.
Can
and
we, like, trick Zynga into going over there and seeing these games and making copies by accident?
Right.
Because, like, I feel like there's a way to flip this into a thing that we can start playing.
Turn that negative into a positive somehow.
We've got Gree. That's, you know, it's Japanese.
Fuck. I'm not going to tell Steve you said that.
That's where gaming is going. I see it at the airport all the time.
Yeah, gaming is
going. That's where I get all my good, you know, it's God like server architecture. And,
yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, basically, if I could do anything, it would be to bring back, like, that feeling I think a lot of us had from stuff like Vib Ribbon and Baby Universe and that kind of stuff.
That's the stuff, like, you know, even like, just like, I haven't been to TGS since I think 08, but you know, even the last few times I'd gone before that, it just seemed like a lot of that spirit was working its way out of the mainstream market.
I think so, yeah. Well, and that brings me to another point why I'm here, is to get you guys to come to Japan. Like, what do I have to do
to
get Giant Bomb to come to Japan?
We're due. Like, we're way overdue.
You're way due. Yeah,
totally.
Way due.
In the budget?
Sell that copy of, like, Bible budget. Buffet or whatever, Jeff, that you have, Mint in Box or whatever. That's going to pay for, like, a four-man film crew.
Right.
You guys can do a Kickstarter.
The Kickstarter would
have
other
overnight plans.
Okay. But seriously, let's have it now on record. We would love to have you guys.
Yeah, totally. I want to get back out there this year. I mean, I think the case could be made with new consoles and stuff. It's going to be a big year at TGS anyway.
Yep.
But more importantly than that, I just want to get out there and buy a shitload of PC Engine games.
Nice, yes.
And just,
I just bought a Famicom Twin, so I'm jonesing for...
Like, I want to go on the most soulless... And that's the, you know, like going out to TGS, especially when Space World existed still.
Right.
I was spending 3 weeks a year in Japan, and I was bringing an empty suitcase with me and just filling it up. It's like, okay, now I got Shikato Tambourine with Minamoni Girls on it, and I'm getting all these Famicom discs and airsoft guns and just like the fucking worst shit in the world. Just like packing.
Right, you would pack a suitcase inside of a suitcase
so that I could separate them.
Did you never have trouble going back on the plane with the perfect replica black airsoft gun?
No, because on the Japan side, which is the only place where they open it,
oh, okay.
They know
they were
what
like,
those
it's
are.
An air gun. Okay.
But, so one time, I've told this story, but one time, the first time we brought guns back, me and Ryan McDonald, wherever he is around here, they open up the box in Japan, and then they pull the gun out. Guy just pulls it out, looks at it, like in the middle of the airport.
Right.
Line of Americans behind
me. Pre-9/11.
Yeah. Pre-9/11.
Yeah.
But still, pulls this very realistic looking gun. And
no
everyone
orange tip. No.
Right. Yeah,
no,
exactly.
No, nothing.
If everyone in the line behind is just looking at it. I turn around, there's people just like. Yeah. And then he just puts it back in the box, closes it, and goes.
Did you look back at it?
Okay,
like,
that's right. That's right. That's right.
My first trip to Japan, I bought a Glock replica, which is a plastic gun basically made so that people could sneak it onto planes.
Right.
And so I'm like coming into the airport to the check thing, and people would bomb the airport every once in a while, so they actually get paranoid about security out there. And I'm like, all right, I have to explain this to them before they find it in the briefcase, or else it's probably going to like look bad.
Yeah. But so those were the most soulless trips, because we were up all night writing articles based on what we were seeing at Space World or TGS and trying to get it up. And so you didn't sleep at all at some point. I tried to find drugs that would help me not sleep, and that was really weird. But
that's
then
another story.
Yeah, I would fill the rest of the time with like, all right, we got to get back out to Akihabara because I need to buy more Neo Geo games. And it just became like, you know, like that is the extent of my trips to Japan. No culture. No culture outside of the used game culture. And then stumbling
and
into
Kurt
weird
shops.
And weird porn shops.
Beef bowls.
Yeah. Which now all the game shops are porn shops.
Yeah.
From what it seemed like
PC
last time
floors,
I was out there.
At least,
right.
For sure.
Yeah.
What's up? Holding your mic.
Yo, I gotta go.
You gotta go?
I gotta go.
Aw.
I should probably roll out of here
we
as
gotta
well.
Go.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, so, does the rubber band work on your Famicom Twin, by the way?
Have
you
it
tested
does.
The disk drive? Okay.
It does.
That's the first thing to go.
It's,
you know
it's
that,
currently
right?
in good shape, so I don't have to worry about
mine
that just
a,
yet.
Mine has an audio hum coming out of it that's a real bummer. But yeah. But yeah, so.
Well, if you need replacements, they sell them. So just tell me.
Longer story short, I want to get back out to Japan this year, and if we can't make it work on a weird business sense, I'm just going to say fuck it and go.
Do it.
Drew.
Make it happen.
Yeah.
You got a place to stay.
Let's take a quick break here. And we will say goodbye to John Drake and Mark McDonald. Thank you guys so much for coming out. Finally getting John Drake on camera here.
It's been like 4 days.
I know. I was getting the shakes. Like, look at these hands. It's terrible.
You should talk to Mark about maybe getting Rock Band out in Japan.
Yeah,
there you go.
It would go over really well.
Yeah.
Wouldn't say be a huge boondoggle that lost
his face. Actually, Rock Band was coming out in Japan.
All right,
yeah.
I'm not talking about this.
My idea for Rock Band.
That's
Japan.
What I'm about.
Right. Garth and Casey, we're going to keep you on for another segment. We'll, we'll bring in some fresh faces, but stick around. We'll be back in a second with more Giant Bomb GDC 2013 After Hours. Stay tuned. Wait for it. And we return from our break. Giant Bomb's GDC 2013 After Hours show continues. Still on the couch, Garth and Casey from Firaxis.
Sorry, I'm really sorry.
No, that's good. That's. I gotta say, I was mesmerized by your giant fucking watch over here.
You like this?
During that last segment. Look at this thing. That's a beast.
My wife, who is extremely... doesn't understand the gaming industry. She actually got me this, and I thought it was kind of stylish.
Yeah.
And rubber, gray, kind of looks slaty. I mean, she did something a little different.
It's a slick
non-traditional.
Thank
you.
I like it. It caught the
eye. Thank you, Kristen.
joining us on the couch is Ramiro. You're the creator of Hokra.
Yeah.
Which is Max...
Hokra.
Hokra.
Okay. Yeah, no,
correct Hokra. Me. No, Hokra. Please.
Hokra. You are corrected, sir.
Are you running?
You are corrected.
Are you running PR on this? What's going on, Max?
I'm his agent.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what this industry needed was more agents. So thank God.
Whenever he asks me a question, I'm going to look at Max and be like, "Is it okay for me to answer?"
Is it Hokra or Hokra?
How many players in the game? He's like, "Oh,
I heard 13 players. Is that right?" Yeah. Okay.
Accurate.
I won't correct you. Yeah. I'll change the game right now. 13 players. Sure. I can live code. I can do it.
Well, pleasure to have you. This is a game that Max literally would not shut up about at E3 last year.
It was my number one game of the year.
It was your only game of E3.
Along with XCOM was my other number one game of the year.
Was it really? Are you just saying that because we happen to be here?
No, he did a top 10 list for us as part of our game of the year feature. Due to, I'm not sure, formatting or communication issues, every single game on his list ended up being listed as number one, which I posted it that way, awesome. Assuming that it was like a joke he was making, and then he was like, no, it was supposed to be numbered this way, and I'm like, ah, fuck it.
Wait,
like
where was Hokra?
It was up there.
In your real list? No, I want to know.
It was two or three.
Where was XCOM?
XCOM was up there as well. I think it was I think it went XCOM and then Hokra.
Oh.
So
brutal. That's
right. You guys simply couldn't hope to compete with Hokra's budget.
I saw his hesitation. There's two big guys here versus just one big guy. He's a little worried after
he's gonna gang up.
Talk. Who's gonna? Yeah.
And my arm is useless, so I'm of no help to anybody.
Yeah, he's just changing his list right now.
That's right.
Next week he's going to come
back.
You
might have been actually
in front
of us. He's
going to come back on with a new list.
That's right.
whatever pleases the people around.
Right.
So Max, finally seeing you again. I feel like it's been upwards of minutes.
Yeah.
This is the joy of having PAX East and GDC back-to-back like this.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for your involvement in our panel, in making it such a special night.
I was catching up on the podcast. I'm glad you guys enjoyed the music as much as we did.
Oh, absolutely! And like it was really funny to us of like, yeah, you know, the Harmonix guys coming up to us and be like, oh, I burned you guys, got you. It's like, what? No, that was awesome. That was such a great thing.
It was all in good fun.
Awesome, rad fun. But you know, we now have John Drake's motherfucking number, so we have. Oh, I shouldn't talk about that any further. Let's move on.
If you want to fuck with them, just email them an animated GIF in line in the email, and it will ruin the Harmonix email server. I think they told me to this day it's still fucked up from the one GIF I sent them.
That's a really bad thing to say on a live stream.
Yeah, someone's got someone's Harmonix address.
Somebody's going to test that.
Yeah.
It'll turn real rotten real quick.
Forward to Harmonix all.
Yeah.
There it is. Patrick Klepek also joining us here on the couch.
I live. I had a Subway sandwich, and I feel 1,000 times better now.
That's how bad GDC has treated you so far. Subway sandwich. Like, oh, thank God. Yeah, that's what I needed. That weird bread.
I needed some questionable meatballs. So.
Oh, you got a meatball?
Yeah.
You're shooting for the stars, man. I respect that. Just full gamble.
Well, I wanted to make sure. Like, I didn't know where the night was going to go. It's like,
well, now
sure
I do.
The bathroom in 20 minutes.
Yeah, exactly.
I think it's the PBR that's making you feel better.
Yeah. It's a combination of a lot of factors. Like, going right in from PAX East to GDC, and then I went straight to GDC stuff at 9 a.m. on Monday.
All of us took off from Boston from PAX East on Sunday, and the rest of us were ruined. You jumped right back into GDC first thing Monday.
Yep. But it's been, you know, I like going into the design panels and trying to learn a little bit. I feel like it informs my writing process. So as tiring as it has been, it has been super educational and a lot of fun.
Excellent. Well, I want to talk to my Firaxis boys here since we've now had you on for a bit and have not gotten a chance to talk to you directly. Casey, Garth, how you guys doing?
We're doing wonderful.
Awesome.
Thank you so much for having us here. This feels like a beautiful bookend to
the Enemy Unknown process. And it's fitting coming back to Giant Bomb. We love you guys.
Yeah, well, we're obviously huge fans as well. So have you guys been giving any talks or just going to stuff?
We did. Our art director, Greg Furch.
Yes.
He gave a talk today. It was Alien Autopsy. It was on the art direction of Enemy Unknown, which was pretty interesting. It was a mix of the art process, but also the design constraints and the sort of things that the team had to do holistically because of the design decisions made on XCOM. So,
well, it's an interesting thing because, you know, that game has a history and a very specific aesthetic already associated with it. So to kind of try and keep that going, and, you know, I guess modernize it to some extent and, you know, maybe bring a little more variety to it.
That's right. There's always a story that goes with that. But, you know, a lot of things at Firaxis, the gameplay, it sounds kind of cliche, but, you know, when I came on board on Firaxis, you hear things like gameplay first and design driven. We're all video game companies. We want to find the fun, every single video game company. But Firaxis is a little bit of a different beast. I mean, you have someone like Sid Meier who, that's what he does. He's an engineer and a designer, and he prototypes fast and quickly, finds this awesome new mechanic. And then the other disciplines like art, they're there to support that. They're there to make the best possible art within the priorities that design makes. And I saw it in action with a lot of Sid's prototypes, so it's cool. And that was, XCOM was a microcosm of that as well, with, you know, Jake's priorities and things.
Well, I do know that, you know, when SimCity launched and I couldn't play it, I decided instead to just start a Sim Golf live stream.
And, did you do another one?
Yeah, just at home. Oh, I was like, best. I can't get these servers to recognize anything, so fuck it. I know another Sim game that will work.
Ryan, we were campaigning pretty vigorously for a Sim Tower reboot. I'd be pretty excited about that.
Yeah, sure. Well, Ute's Tower, which is basically a Sim Tower,
there's
is on
iPad version.
That. That's pretty decent.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, those things go, which is a perfect segue since just recently Firaxis announced, and you're talking a little more about iOS iPad version of XCOM Enemy Unknown. So going from full-blown, you know, box retail, PC, 360, PS3 game, and now, you know, shifting over to the iPad, like, what's that experience been like for you guys?
I'm just extremely excited about this. I mean, for me, this is like saying, you know, take one of your favorite traditional AAA experiences from something like the PC or console and say you can play it in its full-blown glory mobile on tablet. And that, I don't think that's happened traditionally in this market. You have companion apps, you have slices, really cool experiences with other games, but we want to give fans the full XCOM gameplay experience. And I believe Jake already talked to you a lot about it.
Yeah, I saw it this morning, and it's like,
is it in the dump truck?
Yeah, it went up as you guys are doing the first segment.
Fantastic.
And check the dump truck for.
How do you guys feel about being in the feature, the interview dump truck feature?
What's that? What's your dump truck feature?
So,
are you comforted? I mean, on a scale of 1 to 10,
disturbing, but I want to hear about it.
So it was our catch-all name when we were coming up with multiple like podcast feeds for the site when coming up on the relaunch here, because previously we had just, you know, there was the Giant Bombcast, that was it.
Yeah.
So we were like, we want to have variety to be able to put things up that don't necessarily match the weekly podcast format that we have, but, you know, something like a GDC interview done on a phone. Or whatever else.
Right.
So,
right.
Like our placeholder, and this always happens to us. This literally always happens to us, where someone just wraps in a quick like placeholder name. Like, I don't know, we're just gonna throw everything there. Like, call it just internet, interview dump truck. That'll be fine.
Right.
What's this video? Let's call it a quick look. I guess like we're just gonna look at this game, you know, a couple minutes. So yeah, that's a good name. And then it sticks.
Yeah.
We end up like just putting something up under that and going like, we're not sure if we like this name. And then it just catches somehow, and then we're kind of...
That was a great cover-up, Ryan. There's some evil reason for dump truck.
Yeah, dump truck interviews they don't like. That's what they're trying to tell you.
Well, that was the thing. It was like, we're like, this is a terrible name. Who wants to be associated with this feature called the dump truck?
But then
sounds terrible.
But then I did a dump truck on Monday.
That's the reason now they are. Yeah,
right, like, but then someone tweeted out, like, the guy I interviewed was like, oh, I did an interview dump truck with Giant Bomb and then linked to it, and I was like, well, I guess it sticks. Like, that's how we're going to use it that way.
Also, we were internally, like, in my mind at least, it was like, that is the interview dump truck.
Yeah.
Not the, now all of a sudden it's like, oh, the individual things are, that is a interview dump truck.
You'd
like,
you take a dump truck, right?
Yeah. We're going to have to change the name. Like, I do want to double down on it in some level. because it's really funny, but like there are just too many times where like I thought about like having like a serious interview with some serious subject, and I don't want to point people to the dump truck.
Totally sounds like
you should probably work for somewhere other than Giant Bomb. Then I'm sorry.
I know. And again, even as I'm just saying we should change it so I can say that I said it out loud, so that when we don't change it,
yeah,
you're like,
well,
we
I pushed
it.
For it. Like I was saying, we needed to. Obviously,
sorry, Miyamoto. I was really trying. But we're doing a dump truck right now.
We wouldn't do a video thing with Miyamoto probably because it takes so much editing. So it would be an audio interview, and it would go in the dump truck.
It would go in the dump truck. Throw it in the dump truck.
Miyamoto's. Reflects on the Wii U and the interview dump truck.
We've got theme music in the works. It'll be here by the weekend. So look forward to that.
God,
but yeah, so there is a interview dump truck with Jake Solomon.
So we're excited about iOS.
Yes,
we are.
Yes. Which is professional.
Yes.
Which is not
PR's
a dump
watching.
Truck.
No, that's not a dump truck.
I guess I don't want to get too into this stuff, but. I could see there. I know. I just don't want to.
just put it in the dump
truck. It's completely
that goes.
I'm just meh. I don't wanna. I like XCOM and everything, but
put it in the dump truck.
This whole segment
back
could just go
dump,
in the dump
there
truck.
There really is some secret joke happening right now.
So. No, it's very public. When you say dump truck over and over again, it's stupid.
It's a funny name.
It's a great name. You guys are going to start a new trend in journalism.
What a terrible website.
New York Times dump truck.
That's right. That's right.
That just becomes like podcasting. That just stuck as like the shorthand name for this format. Now everyone just thinks Adam Curry.
I'm a professional dump trucker, Mom. That's what I do, right? And it's a real job these days, okay? You're just not modern.
I dump trucks, okay? It's what I do. I wanted to ask you guys, though, about just like the inherent challenge of Like you're saying, Garth, that you know this is taking a full-on, full-blown, you know, for lack of a better word, in my mind right now, like you know, real game type game,
right?
You know, of that scale, and bring it down to iOS, and especially as far as interface stuff goes, because it seemed like a lot was learned from CivRev, from Civilization Revolution, you know, the first Firaxis console game, that you know, a lot of lessons about interface and stuff. That got folded into XCOM Enemy Unknown, but now you're taking this other step of now taking that experience, and then you know going into a pure touch format. Like what have been the challenges in that?
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. I mean, you touched on the interface, which often goes it goes not unnoticed, but it's sort of like that'll happen. You know, it'll work on this new device, whether it's going from PC traditionally to console or console to iOS. And that's always a huge effort. It's a Herculean effort to get the controls to feel smooth, to feel precise, to keep the player in a state of flow. And that took a lot of time to get. But we feel like we're really getting there with the iOS right now. And there's clearly a lot of large challenges. You could talk on the technical aspects if you want with the size. I mean, we have a huge game. But there's also some things that we think work in Enemy Unknown's favor, with it being a turn-based game on tablet.
Absolutely.
I mean, in a lot of ways, I'm confident that it'll control just as well, if not feel better in some ways, with respect to moving your troops and controlling a turn-based game.
The turn-based part, like that, makes it like such a no-brainer. Of like, I can do a turn, you know, lock it up, and then come back to that.
That's right.
That later.
That's right. But even controlling your troops, I mean, it's not a real-time or pseudo-real-time system. So using your finger to drag and move them to cover here, it's a lot. It's an easier problem to solve than simply trying to do a Batman, you know, Arkham Asylum, you know,
right, you're not like
iOS
tilting
experience.
the tablet around to try and move stuff. Like that's always a nightmare experience.
That's right.
Don't do that.
That's right. No, we do. I don't think we're not tilting an XCOM iOS, right? No. No aim, like, increase accuracy.
Oh,
like,
we should.
Tilting a little bit better.
Totally should.
Yeah, actually
I can, once I get into aiming mode, I can use that to, like, switch from target to target. That'd be really good.
Actually,
everyone wants dexterity elements in their XCOM, because it's not hard enough.
Right.
Physics-based, you go like this, all the enemies just fall to the side.
There you go.
Just go rolling.
Start introducing gravity into it from the
Katamari
tilt.
XCOM.
But it's a huge thing too to put on iOS size-wise and memory-wise. So
yeah, the
hopefully people
will
want
to.
They did.
Yeah,
it's a full-featured
which
console
devices
game.
It's going to be. It's going to work on. Is it going to work on mini as well as regular?
I iPad? Believe it's just. It's going to be iPad and iPhone to start. Okay, I can say that.
will definitely be on the iPad.
All right.
Yes. And I guess future announcements
that's
are
right.
coming
yep.
about price and release and
yeah, yep.
all
none
that
of that
stuff.
Has been
but
talked
what
about yet.
I want to know, Garth.
What do you want to know?
Is when am I going to get some new XCOM experience? Because I've played XCOM Enemy Unknown to death.
So there's this new thing coming on iOS, XCOM Enemy Unknown.
Oh,
brand new! Brand new.
I know you guys are teasing stuff, so.
Yeah, we are. There was a really cool teaser at PAX, which. I'm ashamed I couldn't be there to be made fun of at the panel with my losses in multiplayer to Chris Cluey. I heard about that, but they teased at the panel. If you were there at the end, that there will be some forthcoming content. And unfortunately, that's all we can say at this time. But we're really confident that the folks that are interacting with us now and talking about Enemy Unknown will be very pleased.
Excellent.
Yes.
Can't wait. All right.
I can't wait either.
Romero. Let's talk about Hokra. Hokra, Max?
Hokra.
All right, we actually have a build in the house.
I've got something else for you guys as well. I heard on the podcast that you guys were, I heard you were talking about, you had a whole pie conversation. So I thought I would bring something by for you guys.
Just dump something
God
off?
God damn it.
Yeah, Jeff is still around.
I really didn't think this was going to come back around to bite me this quickly.
This is really fast. Yeah.
This is way faster than I was expecting.
Escalation, man. No, I brought some banana cream pie from Tartine Bakery.
Oh. Well, let's get this pass those plates over.
So you want to tell us a little bit more about XCOM? So how much will it be?
Oh, oh wow. I'm just going to lift it up.
That looks
presented.
It's going to be messy.
Here, yeah, let's just knock that box out of the way. Yeah, that'll
what
be
are those things on top?
It's just, you know, shredded chocolate, I'm sure.
It's from the dump truck.
you don't know how true that is based on the joke.
Yeah. We've already talked about escalation since our PAX panel, and I won't go into excruciating detail on that, but...
Can you give a high-level overview of the PAX panel? I was following all the tweets about it. I couldn't be
there, I really can't.
You can't these two or three things happen.
No, I can't. Right.
Nothing about it was high-level. That makes it that much more appealing.
Like, I'm so pissed I missed it.
Yeah, there is no high level when it comes to our panel. It all
starts here.
Very low level.
And you just hope you don't go any lower.
It's low level, and then you have, hell level, apparently.
The funniest thing about our PAX panel, our PAX East panel, this last one that we did specifically, is how many people assumed that everything that happened was planned. That we have this grand idea of like, this is the architecture of how this is going to go down. We're going to make it all look like, this is just randomly happening. We had no idea. Look at the surprise look on our faces. You fucking don't know us if you think that's the case. We are not capable of that level of orchestration. This all just happened, and the shocked look on our faces was 100% genuine. So, anything that happened during that panel,
I kind of want to know now.
Yeah,
how bad did it get?
We have like, we shot the whole panel. Okay. We have it up on the site. It's in two parts.
It's worth a watch. It's honestly got to be it's the funniest panel. It's the funniest PAX thing I've ever seen. That whole hour.
Really.
And no one from the PAX organization has, contacted me and said, you can't come back now.
have they talked about you coming back? Let's wait until you submit
the panel for PAX Prime. And,
well, I feel kind of bad about this because, we don't submit panels. We just go.
They just assume these assholes are going to show up.
No, because there's some rooms that are just, they leave empty because they don't rent every single room, right? You guys just took one of those, right?
no, it's one of the big, 1,200-seat auditoriums.
Capcom arrives and they're like, oh, we're supposed to be doing something. We're
scheduled. What I'm saying is that we just don't submit a thing. They just say you're going to do a panel, right? We're we're going to do a panel. They're like, okay, we'll hold a spot for you. And then, at the last minute, I submit a panel description that's complete nonsense.
Nice.
All right.
And the cycle continues. And then we fill the room and the cycle continues. So,
so let's check out this game.
Yes. Let's check out this game that Max.
What game?
Okra.
Oh, look at that. That's
that
French version.
That's pretty good.
That's almost too good.
There's a little stealth H in there. Yeah. Romero, while you get the setup, Max, since you're running lead PR on this, you want to just break down
what this game is? Yeah, this was a game created for NYU's No Quarter.
Is that accurate? Yeah, you're good so far.
2012?
This is great.
2011. 2011.
Yeah.
And it's a sports game. It's a kind of a minimalist sports game for four players. And so I've been hearing about it online. There's like really crazy buzz when this thing would pop up in like galleries or at parties or something. People would go crazy for it. And I started, I saw it at the IndieCade display at E3.
Yeah.
And it was just, I mean, this is the most, I mean, this is easily like one of the most fun games I've ever played. So just totally captured my imagination.
I just pretty recently saw my first actual gameplay footage of this game in action, and immediately saw the appeal of just that stripped down kind of sports game nature of it. But also, I was completely blown away by the audio.
Yeah.
By just the sound design in this game.
The one thing I didn't do.
It was easily my favorite part of... No, just like because everything else does have this extremely, you know, minimalist feel to it. To contrast that with what sounds like, you know, very, you know, real life sports commentary, like something you'd hear in a soccer match or a football game or whatever.
So you see, it's a little bit of a trick. The commentary is just running during the attract mode. In the game, there's no commentary.
Okay, well, then I saw footage that had
that. Oh, yeah, you must have seen the video. Yeah, we totally just slide on the foot. Like, we just put the commentary over.
I've been tricked.
Yeah.
We actually should have just let him think what he thought, man.
Yeah, no. But then, see, he's making... I'm going to start changing the game. I'm just going to say yes to everything he says.
There it is.
And then when I get home, it's like, shit, I got to make all this commentary. Like,
yeah, how do I dynamically generate commentary for this?
Call the Bastion guys. Call the Bastion guys, quick.
I'll just call up John, and John Madden can just do it.
Dude, just get on a bus. He doesn't fly. So.
Ryan Dibbs as dynamically generating audio to John Madden and tilting RPG to XCOM iOS.
There you go. I'm basically a game developer at this point.
Yeah, exactly.
I belong.
Yeah, you're developing my game against my will. And my Max and I are just like, yes, the audio. Yeah, 13 players. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, what platforms do you want it on? We'll put them all on.
Next gen only. What, it's the only thing that makes sense.
Yeah, it's only coming out for PS5.
That's right.
I'm sorry.
Skipping this one, like,
that's already old news.
We can't run on that sort of hardware. We need more.
Oh, you'll see for these graphics? Yeah. Yeah.
I literally cannot wait any longer.
So what do you guys need to look at this screen to play? So do you want me to move this?
Yeah, we should probably move beers then.
Can you see over the pie?
I can.
All right.
Because it's...
The pie is obstructing everything else for me, but I can't see over it. We'll have it up on the feed here. We'll have it up on the screen.
Are you going to have it up on the feed?
Yeah, okay. We'll be good.
All right, so here's the deal for the gameplay. So yeah, as Max said, it's a minimalist sports game. It's kind of my attempt. I play a lot of like FIFA and real life sports and just really love sports. And it's my attempt at taking sports games and making it so that everyone likes them. Because really my friends, both my like non-gamer friends, but also my hardcore gamer friends don't play sports games.
Right.
And either because they're not into the whole sports fantasy thing or because it's so complex. You think of FIFA has like every single button and then one of them's a modifier makes like all the other buttons be something else. And so basically this game...
That's definitely been a complaint for years about sports games. Like people who have fond memories of 16-bit, 8-bit days of playing sports games. Like I love those games even though I'm not into football, baseball, whatever, but the game itself was still fun. But now at this point, it's like you have to care about roster updates and all of this, you know, this level of realism to kind of, you know, pull that away.
So yeah, this is my attempt at making like that the game that like the non-sports fans will actually play and care about sports. So the way you control is left analog stick moves, X is the only button. There are no other buttons.
Okay.
So if you don't have the ball, you want to tap X to sprint. If you do have the ball, X passes in the direction you're facing.
Okay.
That's pretty much it. It's two teams, Giant Bomb versus Firaxis.
Oh, yeah. All
right. Oh, yeah. I already won money betting on Patrick earlier today, so
we're good.
I'm feeling it. I'm ready.
Just make sure, Patrick, will you press X?
Oh, we're screwed.
Okay, so we seem to be in the game.
I see text. All right,
Patrick, press X once. All right, so you're player four, okay. And can you press X?
I'm player two.
Okay, then switch some controllers. Let me see. Here, you press X and see which controller that is.
Player three.
So you should switch with him.
Okay.
If this reaches, or you guys might have to just split up the team.
Or you have a handicap and you have to play like.
Oh, I gotta play like this.
Yes.
Is it
for good? Go.
Actually, let's just split up the teams.
All right. Okay. So who's three? Who's four? Let's figure this out. The numbers.
I'm not sure. How can we tell?
I'm pressing X.
One person hasn't pressed anything yet.
Everyone
just press. Somebody press X right now and who's choosing you are. All right, just move around a little bit and you get a feel for who you are. But let us know so that people know who's
here. Right, I'm four.
So I'm one.
So the goal of the game is you want to grab the puck and you want to bring it into your own team's corner. And you want to fill it up with energy, so it'll kind of fill up with squares of energy. And you, when it's in the other team,
I am awesome at this game.
Best.
It's cutting off the corners a little bit here, but it'll be fine.
Oh, so, right, who's purple?
Yeah, who's purple? Who's playing together?
I'm purple.
Who else is purple?
Casey is.
All right.
He can't do two things at once. You're purple.
All right. So yeah.
Nope. Oh. I'm with Ryan. All right. And you said bring it to our color?
Yep.
Yeah. You probably want to be watching this screen, actually, because this screen is looking...
I got it, Ryan. I'm in
there. That screen's cutting off the corners a little bit.
What, I just stay in there?
Yeah. Whenever the ball is in the goal, you're getting points, and it's filling up a little squares.
Okay.
You should probably look at this screen.
Got it.
So he has a disadvantage of that screen. That screen's cutting off a bit. So don't forget, if you don't have the ball, you're going to be tapping X so you can move fast.
That's right. And I can pass it to him.
Yeah, you can pass it. Yeah. So yeah, you want to get rid of it when they come.
Ryan, I'm going to give it to you.
No, no.
You can hold X for a stronger pass.
Patrick, you're dominating here.
Where's the score?
It's filling it whenever you fill the goal completely.
Got you. I see it. Ryan, I'm passing to you.
Yep.
Oh, you intercepted block. It. Come on.
Yeah, nice pass.
So can I just toss this? Can I just toss
it? Yeah, you can toss it ahead.
Oh, look at that pass.
I don't actually have to carry it in there.
Yeah, no. It's whenever the ball is touching the goal, it's getting points.
Oh, go up.
Oh, nice. Trying to do the...
All right.
Pull him there out. You go.
Yep.
Look at that move, right? Oh!
I had it for a second.
Look, I'm going to get back to you, all right? That's good. Throw it ahead. Oh. Don't let him take it.
All right. Catch up. Like, yeah, run after it.
There you go.
I'll give you guys some tips in between, but this is actually going to be close.
Oh, shit.
No.
Yeah, no swearing on the podcast, on the video cast.
I need a secret headphones with Ryan right now. I have a strategy idea.
Nice pass.
No, get out of here. I did kind of juke you. Go ahead, Ryan.
No.
Oh, I took it.
Yep.
Nope. This game is awesome.
Thanks. What's going on here, Greg?
There you go, Ryan. Nice. Look, we got to keep it moving. Back to you.
Oh, nice.
There you go. Shoot at this.
Nope, I got took.
That's all right. Here it comes. Back to me. Oh.
All right, yeah.
I got you.
He's stunned me.
Oh, bro, we'll just get it in there. You just need a couple of squares. Or they'll score for you.
I tried passing.
Nicely done.
Okay, that was awesome.
All right. Thank you.
That was awesome.
So who was green and what happened? I want to know.
That we were, Garth and I were green. I was terrible at the game. I think was primarily the thing. Getting the hang of like how the dash move, like how far that's taking you.
Yeah. So whenever you're dashing, you completely lose control while you're dash, and it takes you. It takes you like a little bit of the screen. It's not that much. Yeah. So it's like
also
like,
just realizing like we both need to not be in the exact same spot.
Yeah.
Like.
Yes.
You definitely need some zone control.
Yeah. The best technique is always you split. You always want to split.
Once Garth started kind of passing to me, I started understanding. Yeah. Okay, I need to be where that's going to be, and then once I'm there and they're converging on me, I need to get rid of the ball before they get at me. So
a couple of things: you can throw the ball ahead and then run after it, and you kind of want to do that a lot. You don't want to be holding on the ball for too long,
right?
Otherwise, you're moving really slowly, right? Yeah. And the other thing is, you can do stronger passes by holding X for a while and then letting go, so you can kind of like blast it across the screen.
Got it.
That can be useful. So often when I have the ball, I'm holding X, like getting ready for that pass. You guys want to try a rematch?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, that was awesome.
So on that monitor, for some reason, it's cutting off a little bit. So you have a slight advantage. The edges are cutting off.
Where's the balls? Ryan.
Yeah. Okay.
So hold on. Can I show my teammate? Because we have to learn to get better. A little post-mortem here. You had one pass, man.
How is that even possible?
You had one pass.
I passed it.
No, you got to pass it to him. It's not passing to the opponent. It's not a pass. That's called a turnover.
That's still counts.
Nine turnovers.
Yeah, I led. No, I didn't even lead in turnovers. So whatever. Player four leading turnovers.
I had mad steals. Oh, my turnovers were bad.
This is cool. All right.
Somebody press start and try the same level again. Just everyone press X and then press X because it takes a bit to get used.
Different levels.
Yeah, there's a bunch of different like arena layouts.
Oh.
Wow. Are we same teams here?
Same teams. Yep. Yeah. So, Team Green kind of got destroyed last time. I'm hoping. Yeah, there you go. See, he's pulling away. Player three pulling away. That's nice.
Hey.
Oh.
Oh, that's a nice juke move. Who was that, Casey?
Yeah.
You got me, you got me.
Get rid of it.
Oh, get rid of it. You got me, you got me.
Nice. And throw it in. Yeah.
Okay, so that's something cool that I didn't actually understand.
Yeah, you don't have to be in there.
You don't have to be in there.
It's whenever the ball's on top of the goal, you're getting points. No matter who's holding it or... Oh, nice. Steal back.
Damn. There you go.
Oh, see, you just scored for them. Sprint in there and... Oh,
good steal. Nice, Ryan.
Oh,
no. Well, you did the strong pass. That's good. You.
Oh!
Nice. Killing it.
Nice.
You are.
Oh.
He's actually pretty close, though.
Oh. Yeah, there.
Ah, my dash.
Oh.
Get that thing out of there. Man.
Oh. Throw it in, throw it in.
No. Oh.
Who is that? I want to know who keeps beating you.
Boom!
Oh, that was threw that right to you.
Other side, Ryan.
Ah.
Oh.
Damn.
Dang. You gotta do little spins in there. Like, get away from them. Run little circles around them. Oh, what's going on?
Nicely done, Garth.
Nice.
Were you being sarcastic?
No,
there?
No, that was good.
Ah, come on!
This is close.
Oh, get out of there!
This was close.
Oh, I tried to do the super pass, it didn't work.
You gotta release it at some point. There.
Do it.
Nice.
Oh, purple's close.
Yeah, but green's going back and forth.
Purple's got this.
Oh,
that's
nice.
Throw away.
Ah!
Oh, purple. Not yet.
Oh, nice.
There you go, Ryan.
All right, green, you gotta...
Other corner.
Nice.
Oh. Yes!
Oh, Patrick, you're just giving this game up.
I know.
Oh!
Oh, yeah!
Oh, this is close.
Oh,
come on.
Get it. Oh, God.
Oh, nope, yep.
If purple scores at all, if purple just gets
no!
it.
Oh, no!
Oh, why do you have it?
Oh, God damn it! Oh, he missed!
Oh, God, you guys are just getting into this!
Yeah!
I hate this game. Hokra!
Oh, Hokra.
Available.
Hog shit! I call it hog shit!
Put it in the dump truck.
That is a proper sports game reaction to losing.
We should
just, fuck this!
It is part of the Sports Friends collection.
Yes.
Not Sports Enemies, Sports Friends.
Sports Friends.
Which also has Bari Ball, and then
Joust and Super Pole Riders.
And Super Pole Riders.
Yeah, it's a collection. We're basically, the way we keep calling it, like the indie Wii Sports. It's like we're putting together four like small local multiplayer kind of minimalist sports games, and yeah, it's coming out on PSN later this year.
Awesome.
And then PC, Mac, and Linux.
Successfully kickstarted.
Yeah, we did a successful Kickstarter. We got 150,000. Nice job, so.
You did the hardest thing, which is hook people like that, man. That's really well done.
Thank you. Thanks.
Very well done.
Excellent. Well, so what other than showing people Hokra?
Just changing the name every time.
The problem is, now I'm going to be perpetually confused. Every time I say it, I can say it with no confidence.
Yeah, you're like, I don't know which the right one is anymore.
It's pronounced hooker.
Yeah, however you say it is okay, as long as you're saying it over and over again.
Exactly.
I'm sure he's fine.
Yeah,
I'm sure
Sports Friends. With that. You say Sports Friends a lot. that's the problem, because the game's called Hokra, but it's part of Sports Friends. So I'm always showing them, like, oh, it's Hokra, but really it's Sports Friends. Like, you're not going to find Hokra on PSN. You're going to find Sports Friends. So.
Say, I'm Johann Sebastian Joust 2. Just tell them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just really just take over that brand. So have you just been showing this game off during GDC? Like, what else have you been doing during the show?
Showing this game. We did, we were in this space at Moscone West with this group called Wild Rumpus.
Yeah.
And they're showing four different local multiplayer games. Actually, one of them is a single player game. But anyway, like very good, like pick up and play tournament style games, and they're doing tournaments one each like late afternoon.
Yeah, so it was Super Hexagon.
Yeah,
right?
We did Super. Yeah, Super Hexagon was the first night, and then we did Hokra on Tuesday night, then two player co-op,
With live commentating,
oh God,
right?
Like, two-player co-op sounds like the most terrifying
Seth
thing.
Killian did live commentating over, like, co-op, which just sounds like the most amazing
I wasn't there for that.
I missed that. Yeah.
So co-op is made by Benefati, who's one of the guys who's part... He's part of sports. He's one of the sports friends. We just accept it. We just call ourselves the sports friends.
You are the sports friends.
Yeah, so he's making this game called Super Pole Riders. And Pole Riders exists already. It's on Flash, so people can play it, but... Super Pole Rider is going to be like a better version with bigger, longer poles.
It says Super Right in it, so
that's the best pitch ever.
bigger, longer poles. No, seriously, like he made Pole Riders and was like, okay, how can I make it better? I don't know if the poles are actually bigger, but if there's a tie towards the end of the game, people can impale each other with the poles to see who wins. And he's like, yeah, that's why I need Kickstarter money.
I can't get publishers to look at my game where you impale people with the poles. So
yeah,
Kickstarter we go.
So we're self-publishing it, which is awesome.
Amazed this worked, by the way, too, because in addition to demoing stuff at GDC, you were hacking on this game 1 minute before our cab came to bring us here.
Yeah, I just changed it a little bit. I can change it a bit right
this
now.
This keeps happening during GDC. We had Divekick in here earlier today, and yeah, Dave Lang said like, yeah,
what, just awesome, you know, game, by the way.
Compiled new code for this last night on my laptop.
Did you guys
get a controller, a Divekick controller?
We don't have one in house, but he brought two here when we were playing earlier
and
today.
And why you should have kept it.
He had to leave. He had to bail. He had to big time us. So.
No, the controller, not him. He can go.
Yeah.
No, nobody cares about David Lang. He can. Yeah. No, that game.
Yeah, you know
awesome.
What? You're gonna fit in just fine, yeah. Here, Romero. You get the tone. Well, not giving a shit about David Lang.
That's the tone.
Speaking of dump trucks. Yeah, to the dump truck.
Take
with
a dump truck on him. David Lang's a good guy.
Oh, we love David Lang.
I've had drinks with him.
The only people that we love are we allowed to give that much shit. Anyone else, we'd feel bad about it. It's like, oh no, that person might hear that and...
We might hurt their feelings.
Yeah, but Dave Lang's like, we know he has no feelings.
Yeah.
He's from Chicago, so you know.
Oh God.
Yeah. I was going to say, there's a whole...
I'm looking at Chicago. You guys didn't even blink at that. You're like, yeah, what?
Yeah.
Yeah,
your feelings.
You got us.
Want some more Malort?
So we
I might after this pie, I'm not sure.
Wash it down with some burning tires.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I needed that then.
So we did a tournament on Tuesday afternoon, and it was so awesome because we had the guy whose voice you hear when the game is sitting there, and that made you believe that there's amazing narration in the game, which
the game still has me. The game still has me.
Okay, so like
do you miss it though?
The footage that I saw. No, okay. I'm way too busy.
Yeah,
it's so quick.
Like I thought about. I mean, it's not like I didn't think about doing it, but it's like, what are you gonna say? Like, oh, he passed the ball. He lost the ball again. He passed the ball again. Hit the wall. Okay, he lost the ball again. It's like such quick movement.
Like an auction.
Yeah, it'd be awkward. But he did do live commentary during the tournament that we did.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. It was him and his name's CJ. He's a writer actually at Ubisoft Montreal. So he's a well-spoken man. And one of the Wild Rumpus guys, Dick Hogg, they got together on stage and they did amazing, amazing color commentary. And it really does make it more interesting when there's just two like people speaking over it. And there was a whole crowd. There was, how many people are there? Maybe like 50, 100 people watching. And it just got exciting. Like towards the last matches, people were cheering and screaming. And that's so totally the feeling I'm trying to go for.
Excellent. Well, I'm excited. And can't wait to see this on PSN. So. Romero, thanks for coming and giving us a little taste of okra.
Thank you.
See, if you say it like that, then it doesn't matter if you're saying it right or wrong.
It never matters if I'm saying it right or wrong.
No.
So, Patrick, we touched on this a little earlier, but you have been the most GDC present member of the Giant Bomb crew. Obviously, you've been filling up the dump truck, as we've mentioned and referenced over and over again.
Backing up the
dump. Yeah, he's been, yeah. Sometimes on Twitter, he'll just post it, beep, beep, and I know, like, oh, your dump truck's coming.
So, and the best part is, the last, I think it was yesterday, when I put up, like, I put them in, like, chunks of, like, two, and then I put them all up on Twitter, or, like, posting the links. The only one you retweeted, though, was beep, beep. Like, not like the links to the content.
Not the link, not the content.
And I went to go check, maybe I just missed it.
Nope, that's absolutely 100% correct. I figure the people that, you know, want to know will see that, and they'll do what I did and be like, ah, new dump truck's in. Let's do this. Yeah. That's how you make it beep, stick, beep. Patrick. Yeah. That's how branding works.
Really? So whenever people actually hear beep, beep, they'll think of Giant Bomb.
That's the you guys really own that dump truck space.
Yeah.
That mind share, if you will. Yeah.
Name five. Name two dump truck-based games. Go. That's it. You see, exactly.
Yeah.
I just thought of Giant Bomb.
That's it. All you thought of was Giant Bomb. That's, again, branding. We're masters of it.
So the idea has been, as one that does, the most, long-form writing on the site, is my time best spent trying to write, one or two articles or, write-ups of panels, when there are plenty of other websites where you can go see that stuff done with, big staffs that can spend a lot more time doing that.
Right.
Whereas, PAX East, GDC, we constantly find ourselves in conversations with, really interesting people. Why not, when I find myself in those situations, I planned some of them, most of them were just talking to someone, hey, how about for 10 minutes, we have, a focused conversation, we'll record it. And when our site relaunched, the engineering and design team made this really nice new podcast tool that, rather than just being kind of stuck in the podcast section, we can promote it on the site, people can listen to it, right on the site, and we'll have it on iTunes next week when we have maybe a different name or something like that, but probably not. And the idea of just highlighting, we have all these, we've been doing this for so long that we know so many people and have these cool conversations, so why not give people, a raw look at some of that stuff that happens? And then it's just so easy to put up on the site, so there are 8 or 10 of them that have gone up in the last week.
I mean, you touched on that. It's absolutely PAX East. PAX East, or PAX in general, is, it's good kind of fan outreach and getting to meet the people who, support the site and make this awful business possible. But also, getting to see our industry friends and folks that we don't necessarily have the time or, aren't in the same city as to meet up with them. But GDC is just all that. Yep. It's just pure, we're checking in with people, seeing people that we don't get to see that, are across the country or just whatever, across the globe in a lot of cases. So having those conversations, being able to capture that stuff, that seems like a much better use than running down. Although I have not been to a GDC panel since probably 2008, since before we launched
the
site.
There's no time, right?
I go and I look at the list and I'm half of these I would go into and would just be completely lost the entire time because it's so dense and technical. I'm I'm too stupid for this, just straight up, and I'm okay with that. But that is the case. But some of them, wow, that sounds incredibly interesting. I'd be fascinated to hear about that. But I just, the time is not there, unfortunately. So, Patrick, you want to talk about, any of your panel highlights?
I ended up kind of sitting in the Independent Game Summit and listening to a lot of the. The reason I go, I'm not sure if there are real specific stories that are all that interesting as much as it's just hearing a little bit about what that process is and then sort of taking that in so that when I end up writing about that stuff, I feel even if it doesn't come across in a sentence I write, I feel when I'm reporting those things or I'm interviewing those people, I have a little bit of a better sense of what it's like to make a game and what sort of those struggles are so that when I'm trying to convey that to readers, maybe that comes across a little bit better.
The great thing about GDC to me, as a non-game developer, is being able to sneak in and kind of peek in on what's going on at the conference. And I think I've said this before, but there's not that many public places or semi-public, as it were, where you can hear developers talking to other developers in a kind of peer setting, where they're not having to talk down to a press idiot like myself or simplify things for more generalized consumption. It's like, no, I'm just speaking to my peers about my process and how we deal with these things. And it, you look at the what's going on, it runs the full gamut from the financial end of things, business management, marketing, to the real nitty-gritty of what's your animation pipeline like, right. How are you guys outsourcing elements of your game? And being able to just catch a little bit of that is it's a great reminder to the folks who see the finished product but aren't sweating the code or that the rest of that process to see that. And to me it's extremely humbling to know to be reminded, because it's very easy to lose the sight of it because you just see these games coming out all the fucking time on everything. It's easy to lose that perspective, like, oh, this stuff just happens. You know, it's like, oh, it's just, you know, the someone clackety clack clack, and now there's this game, and then I play it. You know,
that'd be amazing.
right?
Yeah.
No.
Think how much work you put into everything.
Not true, it's like, because I see the eyes in the developers when they come through after their game is done, and they've got that 1,000-yard stare.
Yeah.
So I know that's not true, but GDC is a unique opportunity to be reminded of that, of just how much hard work goes into. Game development.
It is. It's a
thank all of you guys for the work you do to keep me distracted from my real problems. So,
well, that's cool that you guys recognize that, and that, I think that's really creative. What Patrick was just talking about too. I mean, GDC, you have the talks, you have the sessions, and that you look at that and you're like, okay, here's my schedule. I'll pick this hour and the next session and that dressings. But you juggle so many other things, even as a developer, where you're managing these other relationships and you want to meet up with this person and have these conversations that you're talking about that just organically happen, just walking down the block across the street. You run into somebody that you weren't expecting to see. And trying to manage that with the session schedule, which actually, for me, became secondary at this GDC, and just connecting with these people and building these relationships again, is almost more interesting. It's just this supernova of everyone coming together in the industry and just shooting the shit. But you get
like
really
E3,
meaningful nuggets
not,
out of
like,
it.
Hawking products and stuff
no,
like that.
No, not
so
at all.
Like,
right.
There's like way less of like we're selling. You know, like everyone can kind of drop
right.
some of that
right,
stuff.
Right, right. Except XCOM iOS. But yeah, but
that's beyond. A key distinction to make. Of like if you're talking to someone, you can talk about something that's not a product necessarily.
Yeah. Yeah, it's. I mean, E3 is just so stressful. If you're there, I just call it booth babying. When I'm there, like booth babying my game.
Yeah.
Like there is no time. There's zero time. In GDC, there's no time. But at least it's like all these different things you're doing that are super interesting. In E3, it's amazing because you get. I mean, I got to show my game at E3 last year with at the Indiecade space, and it was amazing because there were all these people who wanted to play my game and talk about my game and write about my game, and it's amazingly awesome. But there's no time.
Yeah.
Right.
So at GDC, it's you finally get to talk to all these super interesting people that you spend all year maybe talking on Twitter and email and whatever, but we finally get to see each other.
Right.
It's
right.
Yeah.
And it's cool as a developer too to see. I mean, we're fans of the industry as well. So, you know, you're going through this year with the Walking Deads and the Journeys and the Dishonors and the Far Cries and Borderlands and to
X-coms.
See these other developers. Yeah, well, we are XCOM. So.
I know, I'm just saying. No.
Just make it so you didn't have to say your own game.
You know it's coming out for iOS?
Oh, is this it?
Yeah.
Say that one more time. I'm just kidding.
It's coming out for iPad. It's coming out Android. I don't know what I have nothing to do with this game.
I think all six people left on the live stream know that it's coming out at this point.
This conversation getting boring? All right, let's go back to the
funny stuff. Like us, right? Six people left.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just watching on the monitor.
Yeah.
Like, the stream got
there's,
turned
there's
off
four
hours
people right
ago.
There, all right? They like it.
Oh, why are the lights off?
But it is cool to see these other people that you admire and the product that you played from them as well. And to finally go tell them, hey, I appreciate it. It was amazing. And the independent game stuff, too. Like, one of my favorite parts was walking through the IGF booth. It was amazing.
And just
seeing these games in motion and immediately being like, wow, like this is a brand new mechanic I've never seen or thought of before, and these guys are doing that, and let's go play it. That's where the kernels of innovation are set. So it's just this awesome concept.
I was pretty thrilled with the IGF Awards, or is it the IGS Awards?
IGF
Awards. Like,
I mean, it's Innovative Games Summit. That's like a track.
Yeah, there's the IGS, which is the
Awards,
summit.
Yeah.
The IGF is the festival.
Yeah. I thought
they could learn a thing or two about branding from us.
Yeah,
clearly.
We'll call Megan up.
You get Megan on the horn. We'll wrap it. We'll figure it out for next year. It'll be totally streamlined.
Yeah, I just I thought like last night they picked they made some really like brave. Like bold picks, like I was so happy for
Cart Life.
Cart Life. Oh, wow. I don't know if you guys have played it, but it's a.
I've heard great things about it.
I've never played a video game where I had a similar experience. I mean, mechanically, it's not. You can't even really talk about that game in terms of its mechanics. It's just it's a game that's got something to talk about, and it gives you this experience that you can't get anyway. And
but
you can't
talk about the mechanics. I mean,
it's
not
missing,
to get
it's
overly
not,
like
no,
design
you're right.
philosophical
it's a solid,
here.
It's a solid game.
No, but the whole point is that the
it's mechanically so difficult, and it's a game about the difficulty. For people who don't know, it's called Kart Life. You can get it online. It's free.
It's on Steam.
There's a free version if you want to play the free version too. And it's a game about the difficulties of running a cart. Like you either sell newspapers, you sell coffee, but basically being a working class person trying to make it with your own business. And the whole game, there's so much mechanically there that makes everything so fucking difficult.
Yeah.
And you're always struggling, and you're always getting by, and you need to go to the courthouse to get a permit, and then the courthouse is closed, and then you don't know where the next thing is, and you don't have money for the cab to get there and fast enough, and everything just goes to shit all the time.
And doesn't it bleed into like their personal lives? Like there's
one of the characters has a kid, and they like
I didn't pick her up. Yeah, I didn't pick her up from school.
But you're like at the courthouse, and you need the permit to open your car. But your kid is at school waiting. You're like, fuck, what do I do? I guess I go pick up my kid. I'll get the permit tomorrow. And then everything is always going to shit. And that's mechanically interesting, I think. I think it's not...
No, I mean, I don't mean to say it has bad mechanics, but that's not like a gamey game. I mean,
There's no
kill cam in that game or any... You know, it's not innovating in that way. It's innovating in a way that I think is like, well, why do we have video games? Like, why are they important? What can they teach us about the human condition?
Yeah.
And that was such a cool... That was just great to see, like, the industry... And you know, like our peers who do like indie games, like recognizing that stuff is important.
And the fact that obviously people are making those kinds of games, but the fact that Kart Life, just Richard who made Kart Life, just put so much love into it. It's not. I mean, like a million. Like there are hundreds of people making games about serious subjects, but to make it that well is just unheard of.
Yeah.
It's also just beautiful. Like visually, so beautiful.
Yeah.
He gave the best acceptance speeches too.
He's an amazing guy.
He was awesome.
He's just a really good guy.
Very endearing.
And he's like that in person too. It's just like
it was cool.
Did you see what he did with his booth?
No.
What did he do? So then because he won the IGF Grand Prize, he gave up his booth to somebody else.
Awesome. There's a game by Porpentine, I think.
Porpentine,
it is.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is a game he really cares about, and he's like, okay, now everyone's heard about my game. Let's make everyone hear about this other game.
Wow.
And he just took off his game and put another game in his booth.
That's awesome.
Yeah, he's a really amazing guy.
Yeah.
So Max, what are you doing here other than delivering pies in comical fashions?
I'm seeing a lot of friends who are doing the IGS. I feel like I'm catching up.
Chakra.
You don't know how to say it anymore.
I know.
You lost it. I'm not going to tell you.
You lost it.
We'll leave you.
You had it, and it's gone.
Let's see. I'm visiting a lot of friends at tech companies, so I'm kind of, I'm getting to see San Francisco. I'm getting to see Facebook and Twitter and all my friends who work out here. And just kind of hanging out and being here at all the festivities. It's I always hear about Rumpus and all this amazing stuff going on around GDC. So it's kind of fun to hang out on the periphery and be here and get to hang out with you guys and.
You've given lectures.
Yeah, I think there's a Kickstarter thing tomorrow that I'm doing. I'm not sure if it's like a talk or a meetup or.
Max gives talks like every day.
Yeah.
He's giving a talk right now.
Yeah.
He's not sure.
I don't know if you see the PowerPoint's back there. Like you can't see it on the camera.
Yeah. And the Wild Rumpus party last night was awesome too.
It was fantastic. It was
There's a little bit of
Needhog there, which was like one of my favorite games. It's kind of only a gallery game, but
well, for now, it should come out in some way. I hope.
And then Kita Takahashi's new game was there as well.
Did you get to play that?
No, the line got too long.
I didn't get to play it. Something about girls peeing on people?
It's like this...
Seriously, I'm not joking.
No, I saw it. It's like saying I love you or peeing on people and differentiating between the two.
Which is hard in real life, right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I'm having trouble right now.
What's it called? DJ Phil LaMarchand.
Oh yeah.
Which is Phil Fish, Fez guy, and Richard LaMarchand, who used to be a lead designer at Naughty Dog. And they DJ together.
The sweatiest thing you have ever seen.
The only time I've seen them play where the cops did not get called, because the cops get called every year at that IndieCade party where they play. DJ'd. Yep, every year like clockwork.
Well, we'll hopefully have Phil on tomorrow night as well as a few other guests. So.
Oh, great! I gotta stop by for that.
Yeah, come back.
Tomorrow's gonna be kind of a party.
Yeah, well, tomorrow will be way crazier
than DJ.
Like. So we definitely went from like
yeah.
We definitely went from tonight of being like, oh no, we have too many guests, to like, oh no, everyone's gonna be here tomorrow. We deferred too many people. So yeah, be sure and come back for. More madness, I'm sure, but you guys want to call this?
Yeah.
Drew, you want to call this?
Sure.
All right, Drew wants to call it, so that's our time here at our Thursday night Giant Bomb GDC 2013 After Hours show. I'd like to thank Garth and Casey from Firaxis for coming. Romero with Hawkra. Looks great. One of the sports friends.
Yeah, sports friends. PSN. Max coming Temkin. To PSN. Yes. Well, you guys coming out on iOS?
Yes, and you're coming out on PSN.
PSN, Hawkra. And then PC, Mac, and Linux later.
PC, Mac, PSN later. First. All right, you got a date. Sunny. You're doing good, man. I like it.
Yeah.
And Max is coming out on...
To a lecture near you.
Yeah. You'll be on Kickstarter.
Oh, you're
now, right? You can live on Kickstarter.
You're kickstarting a project right now, right?
Yeah.
Just launched a new one.
Got a little card game I launched at PAX.
Oh, yes.
On Kickstarter.
Werewolf, right?
That is correct.
But do I have to plug it for you?
Is it
pronounced werewolf? Is it werewolf?
Werewolf.
Werewolf.
Yeah, where's the intonation? I'm not clear. I've not heard this word before.
Werewolf is my favorite game. It's kind of a folk game. It's the same game as Mafia. It just has a different theme and some different characters. If you search on Kickstarter for Werewolf, you can find some information, or on my website if you search my name, or go to the conveniently spelled maxistentialism.com.
Excellent. Well, Max, again, thank you for coming. Hopefully, we can get you back here tomorrow night.
Yeah,
thanks to Mark McDonald from 8-4, as well as the constant John Drake from Harmonix. Always a pleasure. That's it for our show. We'll see you guys later.
That's right. I don't know what you had camera waving to. I'm just waving at Dump Truck.
Nope, yep, there it is. Nope.
Oh, that one.
I'm going to go take a dump truck.